After the Theater by Anton Chekhov. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information and to learn how to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. After the Theater by Anton Chekhov. Nadia Zelenin had just come back with her mama from the theater, where she had seen a performance of Yevgeny Onyegin. Soon after she reached her own room, she threw off her dress, let down her hair, and in her petticoat and white dressing jacket hastily sat down to the table to write a letter like Tatyana's. "I love you," she wrote, "but you do not love me. You do not love me." She wrote it and laughed. She was only 16 and did not yet love anyone. She knew that an officer called Gorny and a student called Gruzdev loved her. But now, after the opera, she wanted to be doubtful of their love. To be unloved and unhappy, how interesting that was! There is something beautiful, touching, and poetical about it. When one loves and the other is indifferent. Onyegin was interesting because he was not in love at all, and Tatyana was fascinating because she was so much in love, and if they had been equally in love with each other and had been happy, they would perhaps have seemed dull. "Leave off declaring that you love me," Nadia went on writing, thinking of Gorny. "I cannot believe it. You are very clever, cultivated, serious. You have immense talent, and perhaps a brilliant future awaits you, while I am an uninteresting girl with no importance, and you know very well that I should be only a hindrance in your life. It is true that you were attracted by me and thought you had found your ideal in me, but that was a mistake, and now you are asking yourself in despair, 'Why did I meet that girl?' And only your goodness of heart prevents you from owning it to yourself." Nadia felt sorry for herself. She began to cry and went on. "It is hard for me to leave my mother and my brother, or I should take a nun's veil and go whither chance may lead me, and you would be left free and would love another. Oh, if I were dead!" She could not make out what she had written through her tears. Little rainbows were quivering on the table, on the floor, on the ceiling, as though she were looking through a prism. She could not write. She sank back in her easy chair and fell to thinking of Gorny. My God, how interesting, how fascinating men were! Nadia recalled the fine expression, ingratiating, guilty, and soft, which came into the officer's face when one argued about music with him, and the effort he made to prevent his voice from betraying his passion. In a society where cold haughtiness and indifference were regarded as signs of good breeding and gentlemanly bearing, one must conceal one's passions, and he did try to conceal them, but he did not succeed, and everyone knew very well that he had a passionate love of music. The endless discussions about music and the bold criticisms of people who knew nothing about it kept him always on the strain. He was frightened, timid, and silent. He played the piano magnificently, like a professional pianist, and if he had not been in the army, he would certainly have been a famous musician. The tears on her eyes dried. Nadia remembered that Gorny had declared his love at a symphony concert, and again downstairs by the hat stand, where there was a tremendous draft blowing in all directions. "I am very glad that you have at last made the acquaintance of Gruzdev, our student friend," she went on writing. "He is a very clever man, and you will be sure to like him. He came to see us yesterday and stayed till 2 o'clock. We were all delighted with him, and I regretted that you had not come. He said a great deal that was remarkable." Nadia laid her arms on the table and leaned her head on them, and her hair covered her letter. She recalled that the student, too, loved her, and that he had as much right to a letter from her as Gorny. Wouldn't it be better, after all, to write to Gruzdev? There was a stir of joy in her bosom for no reason whatever. At first the joy was small and rolled in her bosom like an Indian rubber ball. Then it became more massive, bigger, and rushed like a wave. Nadya forgot Gorny and Gruzdev. Her thoughts were in a tangle, and her joy grew and grew. From her bosom it passed into her arms and legs, and it seemed as though a light, cool breeze were breathing on her head and ruffling her hair. Her shoulders quivered with subdued laughter. The table and the lamp chimney shook too, and tears from her eyes splashed on the letter. She could not stop laughing, and to prove to herself that she was not laughing about nothing, she made haste to think of something funny. "What a funny poodle," she said, feeling as though she would choke with laughter. "What a funny poodle!" She thought how, after tea the evening before, Gruzdev had played with Maxim, the poodle, and afterwards had told them about a very intelligent poodle who had run after a crow in the yard, and the crow had looked round at him and said, "Oh, you scamp!" The poodle, not knowing he had to do with a learned crow, was fearfully confused and retreated in perplexity, then began barking. "No, I had better love Gruzdev," Nadya decided, and she tore up the letter to Gorny. She fell into thinking of the student, of his love, of her love, but the thoughts in her head insisted on flowing in all directions, and she thought about everything. About her mother, about the street, about the pencil, about the piano. She thought of them joyfully and felt that everything was good, splendid. And her joy told her that this was not all, that in a little while it would be better still. Soon it would be spring, summer, going with her mother to Gorbiki. Gorny would come for his furlough, would walk about the garden with her and make love to her. Gruzdev would come too. He would play croquet and skittles with her. He would tell her wonderful things. She had a passionate longing for the garden, the darkness, the pure sky, the stars. Again her shoulders shook with laughter, and it seemed to her that there was a scent of wormwood in the room, and that a twig was tapping at the window. She went to her bed, sat down, and not knowing what to do with the immense joy which filled her with yearning, she looked at the holy image hanging at the back of her bed and said, "O Lord God! O Lord God!" End of After the Theater by Anton Chekhov. Read for LibriVox.org by Alan Davis Drake.
At Owl Creek Bridge by Ambrose Bierce. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Alex C. Tillander, Davis, California. An Occurrence at Owl Creek Bridge by Ambrose Bierce. 1. A man stood upon a railroad bridge in northern Alabama, looking down into the swift water 20 feet below. The man's hands were behind his back, the wrists bound with cord. A rope closely encircled his neck. It was attached to a stout cross timber above his head, and the slack fell to the level of his knees. Some loose boards laid upon the ties supporting the rails of the railway supplied a footing for him and his executioners. Two private soldiers of the Federal Army, directed by a sergeant who in civil life may have been a deputy sheriff. At a short remove upon the same temporary platform was an officer in the uniform of his rank, armed. He was a captain. A sentinel at each end of the bridge stood with his rifle in the position known as support, that is to say, vertical in front of the left shoulder, the hammer resting on the forearm, thrown straight across the chest, a formal and unnatural position, enforcing an erect carriage of the body. It did not appear to be the duty of these two men to know what was occurring at the center of the bridge. They merely blockaded the two ends of the foot planking that traversed it. Beyond one of the sentinels, no one was in sight. The railroad ran straight away into a forest for 100 yards, then curving, was lost to view. Doubtless there was an outpost farther along. The other bank of the stream was open ground, a gentle slope topped with a stockade of vertical tree trunks, loopholed for rifles, with a single embrasure through which protruded the muzzle of a brass cannon commanding the bridge. Midway up the slope between the bridge and fort were the spectators, a simple company of infantry in line, at parade rest, the butts of their rifles on the ground, the barrels inclining slightly backward against the right shoulder, the hands crossed upon the stock. A lieutenant stood at the right of the line, the point of his sword upon the ground, his left hand resting upon his right. Excepting the group of four at the center of the bridge, not a man moved. The company faced the bridge, staring stonily, motionless. The sentinels, facing the banks of the stream, might have been statues to adorn the bridge. The captain stood with folded arms, silent, observing the work of his subordinates, but making no sign. Death is a dignitary who, when he comes announced, is to be received with formal manifestations of respect, even by those most familiar with him. In the code of military etiquette, silence and fixity are forms of deference. The man who was engaged in being hanged was apparently about 35 years of age. He was a civilian, if one might judge from his habit, which was that of a planter. His features were good, a straight nose, firm mouth, broad forehead, from which his long, dark hair was combed straight back, falling behind his ears to the collar of his well-fitting frock coat. He wore a mustache and pointed beard, but no whiskers. His eyes were large and dark gray, and had a kindly expression which one would hardly have expected in one whose neck was in the hemp. Evidently this was no vulgar assassin. The liberal military code makes provision for hanging many kinds of persons, and gentlemen are not excluded. The preparations being complete, the two private soldiers stepped aside, and each drew away the plank upon which he had been standing. The sergeant turned to the captain, saluted, and placed himself immediately behind that officer, who in turn moved apart one pace. These movements left the condemned man and the sergeant standing on the two ends of the same plank, which spanned three of the cross-ties of the bridge. The end upon which the civilian stood almost, but not quite, reached a fourth. This plank had been held in place by the weight of the captain. It was now held by that of the sergeant. At a signal from the former, the latter would step aside, the plank would tilt, and the condemned man go down between two ties. The arrangement commended itself to his judgment as simple and effective. His face had not been covered, nor his eyes bandaged. He looked a moment at his unsteadfast footing, then let his gaze wander to the swirling water of the stream, racing madly beneath his feet. A piece of dancing driftwood caught his attention, and his eyes followed it down the current. How slowly it appeared to move! What a sluggish stream! He closed his eyes in order to fix his last thought upon his wife and children. The water, touched to gold by the early sun, the brooding mist upon the banks of some distance down the stream, the fort, the soldiers, the piece of drift, all had distracted him, and now he became conscious of a new disturbance. Striking through the thought of his dear ones was sound which he could neither ignore nor understand, a sharp, distinct, metallic percussion, like the stroke of a blacksmith's hammer upon the anvil. It had the same ringing quality. He wondered what it was, and whether immeasurably distant or nearby, it seemed both. Its recurrence was regular, but as slow as the tolling of a death knell. He awaited each new stroke with impatience, and he knew not why, apprehension. The intervals of silence grew progressively longer, the delays became maddening. With their greater frequency, the sounds increased in strength and sharpness. They hurt his ear like the thrust of a knife. He feared he would shriek. What he heard was the ticking of his watch. He unclosed his eyes and saw again the water below him. If I could free my hands, he thought, I might throw off the noose and spring into the stream. By diving I could evade the bullets, and swimming vigorously reach the bank, take to the woods, and get away home. My home, thank God, is as yet outside their lines. My wife and little ones are still beyond the invader's farthest advance. As these thoughts, which have here to be set down in words, were flashed into the doomed man's brain, rather than evolved from it, the captain nodded to the sergeant. The sergeant stepped aside. 2. Peyton Farquhar was a well-to-do planter of an old and highly respected Alabama family. Being a slave owner, and like other slave owners, a politician, he was naturally an original secessionist, and ardently devoted to the Southern cause. Circumstances of an imperious nature, what is unnecessary to relate here, had prevented him from taking service with that gallant army which had fought these disastrous campaigns, ending with the fall of Corinth, and he chafed under the inglorious restraint, longing for the release of his energies, the larger life of the soldier, the opportunity for distinction. That opportunity, he felt, would come, as it comes to all in wartime. Meanwhile, he did what he could. No service was too humble for him to perform in the aid of the South, no adventure too perilous for him to undertake if consistent with the character of a civilian who was at heart a soldier, and who in good faith and without too much qualification assented to at least a part of the frankly villainous dictum that all is fair in love and war. One evening, while Farquhar and his wife were sitting on a rustic bench near the entrance to his grounds, a grey-clad soldier rode up to the gate and asked for a drink of water. Mrs. Farquhar was only too happy to serve him with her own white hands. While she was fetching the water, her husband approached the dusty horseman and inquired eagerly for news from the front. "The Yanks are repairing the railroads," said the man, "and are getting ready for another advance. They have reached the Owl Creek Ridge, put it in order, and built a stockade on the north bank. The commandant has issued an order, which is posted everywhere, declaring that any civilian caught interfering with the railroad, its bridges, tunnels, or trains will be summarily hanged. I saw the order." "How far is it to the Owl Creek Bridge?" Farquhar asked. "About 30 miles. Is there no force on this side of the creek?" "Only a picket post half a mile out, on the railroad, and a single sentinel at this end of the bridge." "Suppose a man, a civilian, and student of hanging, should elude the picket post and perhaps get the better of the sentinel," said Farquhar, smiling. "What could he accomplish?" The soldier reflected. "I was there a month ago," he replied. "I observed that the flood of last winter had lodged a great quantity of driftwood against the wooden pier at this end of the bridge. It is now dry and would burn like tinder." The lady had now brought the water, which the soldier drank. He thanked her ceremoniously, bowed to her husband, and rode away. An hour later, after nightfall, he repassed the plantation, going northward in the direction from which he had come. He was a federal scout. 3. As Peyton Farquhar fell straight downward through the bridge, he lost consciousness and was as one already dead. From this state he was awakened, ages later it seemed to him, by the pain of a sharp pressure upon his throat, followed by a sense of suffocation. Keen, poignant agonies seemed to shoot from his neck downward through every fiber of his body and limbs. These pains appeared to flash along well-defined lines of ramification, and to beat with an inconceivably rapid periodicity. They seemed like streams of pulsating fire heating him to an intolerable temperature. As to his head, he was conscious of nothing but a feeling of fullness, of congestion. These sensations were unaccompanied by thought. The intellectual part of his nature was already effaced. He had power only to feel, and feeling was torment. He was conscious of motion. Encompassed in a luminous cloud, of which he was now merely the fiery heart, without material substance, he swung through unthinkable arcs of oscillation, like a vast pendulum. Then all at once, with terrible suddenness, the light about him shot upward with the noise of a loud splash. A frightful roaring was in his ears, and all was cold and dark. The power of thought was restored. He knew that the rope had broken, and he had fallen into the stream. There was no additional strangulation. The noose about his neck was already suffocating him, and kept the water from his lungs. To die of hanging at the bottom of a river, the idea seemed to be him ludicrous. He opened his eyes in the darkness, and saw above him a gleam of light, but how distant, how inaccessible! He was still sinking, for the light became fainter and fainter, until it was a mere glimmer. Then it began to grow and brighten, and he knew that he was rising toward the surface. He knew it with reluctance, for he was now very comfortable. "To be hanged and drowned," he thought, "that is not so bad, but I do not wish to be shot. No, I will not be shot. That is not fair." He was not conscious of an effort, but a sharp pain in his wrist apprised him that he was trying to free his hands. He gave the struggle his attention, as an idler might observe the feat of a juggler, without interest in the outcome. What splendid effort! What magnificent, what superhuman strength! Ah, that was a fine endeavor. Bravo! The cord fell away. His arms parted and floated upward, the hands dimly seen on each side in the growing light. He watched them with a new interest as first one, and then the other pounced upon the noose at his neck. They tore it away and thrust it fiercely aside, its undulations resembling those of a water snake. "Put it back! Put it back!" He thought he shouted these words to his hands, for the undoing of the noose had been succeeded by the direst pang that he had yet experienced. His neck ached horribly. His brain was on fire. His heart, which had been fluttering faintly, gave a great leap, trying to force itself out of his mouth. His whole body was racked and wrenched with an insupportable anguish, but his disobedient hands gave no heed to the command. They beat the water vigorously with quick downward strokes, forcing him to the surface. He felt his head emerge. His eyes were blinded by the sunlight. His chest expanded convulsively, and with a supreme and crowning agony his lungs engulfed a great draught of air, which instantly he expelled in a shriek. He was now in full possession of his physical senses. They were indeed preternaturally keen and alert. Something in the awful disturbance of his organic system had so exalted and refined them that they made record of things never before perceived. He felt the ripples upon his face, and heard their separate sounds as they struck. He looked at the forest on the bank of the stream, saw the individual trees, the leaves, and the veining of each leaf. He saw the very insects upon them. The locusts, the brilliant-bodied flies, the gray spiders stretching their webs from twig to twig. He noted the prismatic colors in all the dewdrops upon a million blades of grass, the humming of the gnats that danced above the eddies of the stream, the beating of the dragonfly's wings, the strokes of the water spider's legs. Like oars which had lifted their boat, all these made audible music. A fish slid along beneath his eyes, and he heard the rush of its body parting the water. He had come to the surface, facing down the stream. In a moment the visible world seemed to wheel slowly round, himself the pivotal point, and he saw the bridge, the fort, the soldiers upon the bridge, the captain, the sergeant, the two privates, his executioners. They were in silhouette against the blue sky. They shouted and gesticulated, pointing at him. The captain had drawn his pistol, but did not fire. The others were unarmed. Their movements were grotesque and horrible, their forms gigantic. Suddenly he heard a sharp report, and something struck the water smartly within a few inches of his head, spattering his face with spray. He heard a second report, and saw one of the sentinels with his rifle at his shoulder, a light cloud of blue smoke rising from the muzzle. The man in the water saw the eye of the man on the bridge, gazing into his own through the sights of the rifle. He observed that it was a gray eye, and remembered having read that gray eyes were keenest, and that all famous marksmen had them. Nevertheless, this one had missed. A countless swirl had caught Farquhar and turned him half round. He was again looking at the forest on the bank opposite the fort. The sound of a clear, high voice and a monotonous sing-song now rang out behind him and came across the water with a distinctness that pierced and subdued all other sounds, even the beating of the ripples in his ears. Although no soldier, he had frequented camps enough to know the dread significance of that deliberate, drawling, aspirated chant. The lieutenant on shore was taking a part in morning's work. How coldly and pitilessly would what an even, calm intonation, presaging and enforcing tranquillity men, with what accurately measured interval, fell those cruel words. Company, attention! Shoulder arms! Ready! Aim! Fire! Farquhar dived as deeply as he could. The water roared in his ears like the voice of Niagara, yet he heard the dull thunder of the volley, and, rising again toward the surface, met shining bits of metal, singularly flattened, oscillating slowly downward. Some of them touched him on the face and hands, then fell away, continuing their descent. One lodged between his collar and neck. It was uncomfortably warm, and he snatched it out. As he rose to the surface, grasping for breath, he saw that he had been a long time under water. He was perceptibly farther downstream, nearer to safety. The soldiers had almost finished reloading. The metal ramrods flashed all at once in the sunshine as they were drawn from the barrels, turned in the air, and thrust into their sockets. The two sentinels fired again, independently and ineffectually. A hunted man saw all this over his shoulder. He was now swimming vigorously with the current. His brain was as energetic as his arms and legs. He thought with the rapidity of lightning. "The officer," he reasoned, "will not make that martinet's error a second time. It is as easy to dodge a volley as a single shot. He has probably already given the command to fire at will. God help me, I cannot dodge them all." An appalling splash within 2 yards of him was followed by a loud rushing sound, diminuendo, which seemed to travel back through the air to the fort, and died in an explosion which stirred the very river to its deeps. A rising sheet of water curved over him, fell down upon him, blinded him, strangled him. The cannon had taken a hand in the game. As he shook his head free from the commotion of the smitten water, he heard the deflected shot, humming through the air ahead, and in an instant it was cracking and smashing the branches in the forest beyond. "They will not do that again," he thought. "The next time they will use a charge of grape. I must keep my eye upon the gun. The smoke will apprise me. The report arrives too late. It lags behind the missile. That is a good gun." Suddenly he felt himself whirled round and round, spinning like a top. The water, the banks, the forest, the now distant bridge, fort, and men, all were commingled and blurred. Objects were represented by their colors only. Circular horizontal streaks of color, that was all he saw. He had been caught in a vortex and was being whirled on with the velocity of advance and gyration that made him giddy and sick. In a few moments he was flung upon the gravel at the foot of the left bank of the stream, the southern bank, and behind a projecting point which concealed him from his enemies. The sudden arrest of his motion, the abrasion of one of his hands on the gravel, restored him, and he wept with delight. He dug his fingers into the sand, threw it over himself in handfuls, and audibly blessed it. It looked like diamonds, rubies, emeralds. He could think of nothing beautiful which it did not resemble. The trees upon the bank were giant garden plants. He noted a definite order in their arrangement, inhaled the fragrance of their blooms. A strange roseate light shone through the spaces among their trunks, and the wind made in their branches the music of Aeolian harps. He had no wish to perfect his escape. He was content to remain in that enchanting spot until retaken. A whiz and a rattle of grapeshot among the branches high above his head roused him from his dream. The baffled cannoneer had fired him a random farewell. He sprang to his feet, rushed up the sloping bank, and plunged into the forest. All that day he traveled, laying his course by the rounding sun. The forest seemed interminable. Nowhere did he discover a break in it, not even a woodsman's road. He had not known that he lived in so wild a region. There was something uncanny in the revelation. By nightfall he was fatigued, footsore, famished. The thought of his wife and children urged him on. At last he found a road which led him in what he knew to be the right direction. It was as wide and straight as a city street, yet it seemed untraveled. No fields bordered it, no dwelling anywhere. Not so much as the barking of a dog suggested human habitation. The black bodies of the trees formed a straight wall on both sides, terminating on the horizon in a point, like a diagram in a lesson in perspective. Overhead, as he looked up through this rift in the wood, shone great golden stars, looking unfamiliar and grouped in strange constellations. He was sure they were arranged in some order which had a secret and malign significance. The wood on either side was full of singular noises, among which, once, twice, and again, he distinctly heard whispers in an unknown tongue. His neck was in pain, and lifting his hand to it, found it horribly swollen. He knew that it had a circle of black where the rope had bruised it. His eyes felt congested. He could no longer close them. His tongue was swollen with thirst. He relieved its fever by thrusting it forward from between his teeth into the cold air. How softly the turf had carpeted the untraveled avenue. He could no longer feel the roadway beneath his feet. Doubtless, but despite his suffering, he had fallen asleep while walking, for now he sees another scene. Perhaps he has merely recovered from a delirium. He stands at the gate of his own home. All is as he left it, and all bright and beautiful in the morning sunshine. He must have traveled the entire night. As he pushes open the gate and passes up the wide, white walk, he sees a flutter of female garments. His wife, looking fresh and cool and sweet, sweeps down from the veranda to meet him. At the bottom of the steps she stands waiting, with a smile of ineffable joy, an attitude of matchless grace and dignity. Ah, how beautiful she is! He springs forward with extended arms. As he is about to clasp her, he feels a stunning blow upon the back of the neck. A blinding white light blazes all about him with a sound like the shock of a cannon. Then all is darkness and silence. Peyton Farquhar was dead. His body, with a broken neck, swung gently from side to side beneath the timbers of the Owl Creek Bridge. End of An Occurrence at Owl Creek Bridge by Ambrose Bierce. Recording by Alex Hetelander, Davis, California. www.alexhetelander.com.
The Bird Market by Anton Chekhov. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Bird Market by Anton Chekhov. There is a small square near the Monastery of the Holy Birth, which is called Trubnoy, or simply Truboy. There is a market there on Sundays. Hundreds of sheepskins, wadded coats, fur caps, and chimney-pot hats swarm there, like crabs in a sieve. There is a sound of the twitter of birds in all sorts of keys, recalling the spring. If the sun is shining, and there are no clouds in the sky, the singing of the birds and the smell of hay makes a more vivid impression, and this reminder of spring sets one thinking and carries one's fancy far, far away. Along one side of the square there stands a string of wagons. The wagons are loaded, not with hay, not with cabbages nor beans, but with goldfinches, siskins, larks, blackbirds, thrushes, bluetits, bluefinches. All of them are hopping about in rough homemade cages, twittering and looking with envy at the free sparrows. The goldfinches cost 5 kopecks. The siskins are rather more expensive, while the value of the other birds is quite indeterminate. How much is a lark? The seller himself does not know the value of a lark. He scratches his head and asks whatever comes into it, a ruble or 3 kopecks, according to the purchaser. There are expensive birds, too. A faded old blackbird, with most of its feathers plucked out of its tail, sits on a dirty perch. He is dignified, grave, and motionless as a retired general. He has waved his claw in resignation to his captivity long ago, and looks at the blue sky with indifference. Probably owing to this indifference, he is considered a sagacious bird. He is not to be bought for less than 40 kopecks. Schoolboys, workmen, young men in stylish gray coats, and bird fanciers in incredibly shabby caps, in ragged trousers that are turned up at the ankles, and look as though they had been gnawed by mice, crowd round the birds, splashing through the mud. The young people and the workmen are sold hens for cocks, young birds for old ones. They know very little about birds, but there is no deceiving the bird fancier. He sees and understands his bird from a distance. There is no relying on that bird, a fancier will say, looking into a siskin beak and counting the feathers on his tail. He sings now, it is true, but what of that? I sing in company, too. No, my boy, shout. Sing to me without company. Sing in solitude if you can. You give me that one, yonder, that sits and holds its tongue. Give me the quiet one. That one says nothing. So he thinks the more. Among the wagons of birds there are some full of other live creatures. Here you see hares, rabbits, hedgehogs, guinea pigs, polecats. A hare sits sorrowfully nibbling the straw. The guinea pigs shiver with cold, while the hedgehogs look out with curiosity from under their prickles at the public. I have read somewhere, says the post office official in a faded overcoat, looking lovingly at the hare and addressing no one in particular, I have read that some learned man had a cat and a mouse and a falcon and a sparrow who all ate out of one bowl.
That's impossible, sir. The cat must have been beaten, and the falcon, I dare say, had all its tail pulled out. There's no great cleverness in that, sir. A friend of mine who had a cat who, saving your presence, used to eat his cucumbers. He thrashed her with a big whip for a fortnight, till he taught her not to. A hare can learn to light matches if you beat it. Does that surprise you? It's very simple. It takes the match in its mouth and strikes it. An animal is like a man. A man's made wiser by beating, and it's the same with a beast.
Men in long, fur-skirted coats moved backwards and forwards in the crowd, with cocks and ducks under their arms. The fowls were all lean and hungry. Chickens poked their ugly, mangy-looking heads out of their cages and peck at something in the mud. Boys with pigeons stare into your face and try to detect in you a pigeon fancier.
Yes, indeed, it's no use talking to you, someone shouts angrily. You should look before you speak. Do you call this a pigeon? It's an eagle, not a pigeon.
A tall, thin man with a shaven upper lip and side whiskers, who looks like a sick and drunken footman, is selling a snow-white lapdog. The lapdog whines.
She told me to sell the nasty thing, said the footman with a contemptuous snigger. She's bankrupt in her old age, has nothing to eat, and here now is selling her dogs and cats. She cries and kisses them on their filthy snouts, and then she is so hard up that she sells them.
Upon my soul, is that a fact? Buy it, gentlemen. The money is wanted for coffee.
But no one laughs. A boy who is standing by screws up one eye and looks at him gravely with compassion. The most interesting of all is the fish section. Some dozen peasants are sitting in a row. Before each of them is a pail, and in each pail there is a veritable little hell. There, in the thick greenish water, are swarms of little carp, eels, small fry, water snails, frogs, and newts. Big water beetles with broken legs scurry over the small surface, clambering on the carp and jumping over the frogs. The creatures have a strong hold on life. The frogs climb on the beetles, the newts on the frogs. The dark green tench, as more expensive fish, enjoy an exceptional position. They are kept in a special jar where they can't swim, but still they are not so cramped. The carp is a grand fish. The carp's the fish to keep, Your Honor. Plague take him. You can keep him for a year in a pail, and he'll live. It's a week since I caught these very fish. I caught them, sir, in Pererva, and have come from there on foot. The carp are 2 kopecks each. The eels are 3. And the minnows are 10 kopecks the dozen. Plague take them all. 5 kopecks worth of minnows, sir? Won't you take some worms? The seller thrusts his coarse, rough fingers into the pail and pulls out of it a soft minnow, or a little carp, the size of a nail. Fishing lines, hooks, and tackle are laid out near the pails, and pond worms glow with a crimson light in the sun. An old fancier in a fur cap, iron-rimmed spectacles, and galoshes that look like 2 dreadnoughts, walks about by the wagons of the birds and pails of fish. He is, as they call him here, a type. He hasn't a farthing to bless himself with, but in spite of that, he haggles, gets excited, and pesters purchasers with advice. He has thoroughly examined all the hares, pigeons, and fish, examined them in every detail, fixed the kind, the age, and the price of each one of them a good hour ago. He is as interested as a child in the goldfinches, the carp, and the minnows. Talk to him, for instance, about thrushes, and the queer old fellow will tell you things you could not find in any book. He will tell you them with enthusiasm, with passion, and will scold you, too, for your ignorance. Of goldfinches and bullfinches he is ready to talk endlessly, opening his eyes wide and gesticulating violently with his hands. He is only to be met here at the market in the cold weather. In the summer he is somewhere in the country catching quails with a bird call and angling for fish. And here is another type. A very tall, very thin, close-shaven gentleman with dark spectacles, wearing a cap with a cockade, and looking of a scrivener of bygone days. He is a fancier, and he is a man of decent position, a teacher in a high school, and is well known to be the habitues of the market. And they treat him with respect, greeting him with bows, and have even invented for him a special title, Your Scholarship. At Suharev Market he rummages among the books, and to Trubnoy he looks out for good pigeons. "Please, sir," the pigeon seller shouts out to him, "Mr. Schoolmaster, your scholarship? Take notice of my Trubners, your scholarship."
"Your scholarship,"
an urchin repeats somewhere in the boulevard. And his scholarship, apparently quite accustomed to his title, grave and serene, takes a pigeon in both hands, and lifting it above his head, begins examining it. And as he does, so frowns and looks graver than ever, like a conspirator. And Trubnoy Square, that little bit of Moscow where animals are so tenderly loved, and where they are so tortured, lives its little life, grows noisy and excited, and the businesslike or pious people who pass by along the boulevard cannot make out what has brought this crowd of people, this medley of caps, fur hats, and chimney pots together, what they are talking about there, what they are buying and selling. End of The Bird Market by Anton Chekhov. Read by Alan Davis Drake.
Bucky Severin by James Curwood. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Reading by Rowdy Delaney, Idaho, USA. Bucky Severin
by James Kerwood. Father Brochet had come south from Fond du Lac, and Wayman, the Hudson's Bay Company doctor, north from Geikie River country. They met at Severn's cabin on the Waterfound. Both had come on the same mission, to see Severn, one to keep him from dying, if that was possible, one to comfort him in his last hour, if death came. Severn insisted on living. Bright-eyed, hollow-cheeked, with a racking cough that reddened the gauze handkerchief the doctor had given him, he sat bolstered in his cot and looked out through the open door with a glad and hopeful gaze. Wyman had arrived only a half an hour before. Outside was the Indian canoeman, who had helped bring him up. It was a glorious day, such as comes in its full beauty only in the far northern spring, where the air enters the lungs like sharp, warm wine, laden with the tang of spruce and balsam, and the sweetness of bursting poplar buds. "It was mighty good of you to come up," Severn was saying to the doctor. "The company has always been the best friend I've ever had, except one, and that's why I've hung on to it all these years, trailing the sledges, first as a kid, you know, then trapping, running, and, oh, Lord!" He stopped to cough, and the little black-frocked missioner, looking across at Wayman, saw him bite his lips. "That cough hurts, but it's better," Severn apologized, smiling weakly. "Funny, ain't it? A man like me coming down with a cough? Why, I've slept in ice 1,000 times, with snow for a pillow, and the thermometer down to 50. But last winter it was cold, 70 or lower, and I worked in it when I ought to have been inside warming my toes. But you see, I wanted the cabin built, and all things cleared up about here, before she came. It's the cold got me, wasn't it, Doc?" "That's it," said Wayman, rolling and lighting a cigarette. Then he laughed as the sick man finished another coughing spell and said, "I never thought you'd have a love affair, Bucky." "Neither did I," chuckled Severn. "Ain't it a wonder, Doc? Here I am, 38, with a hide on me like leather, and no thought of a woman for 20 years, until I saw her. I don't mean it's a wonder I fell in love, Doc. You'd have done that if you'd have met her first. The wonder of it is that she fell in love with me." He laughed softly. "I'll bet Father Brochet'll go a heap in himself when he marries us. It's going to happen next month. Did you ever see her, Father? Marie LeCorne, over at the post on Split Lake?" Severn dropped his head to cough, but Wayman saw the sudden look of horror that leapt into the little priest's face. "Marie LeCorne. Yes, at Split Lake." Severn looked up again. He had missed what Wayman had seen. "Yes, I've seen her." Bucky Severn's eyes lit up with pleasure. She's beautiful, ain't she?" he cried in a hoarse whisper. "Ain't it a wonder, Father? I come up here with a canoe full of supplies last spring about this time, and at first I hardly dast to look at her, but it come out all right. When I told her I was coming over here to build us a home, she wanted me to bring her along to help, but I wouldn't. I knew it was going to be a hard winter, and she's never going to work, never so long as I live. I ain't had much to do with women, but I've seen 'em, and I've watched 'em, and she's never going to drudge like the rest. If she'll let me, I'm even going to do the cooking, and the dishwashing, and scrub the floors. I've done it for 25 years, and I'm tough. She ain't going to do nothing but sew for the kids when they come, and sing and be happy. When it comes to work there ain't no fun in, I'll do it. I've planned it all out. We're going to have half an arpent square of flowers, and she'll love to work among 'em. I've got the ground cleared, out there. You could see it by twisting your head through the door. And she's going to have an organ. I've got the money saved, and it's coming to Churchill on the next ship. That's going to be a surprise, about Christmas, when the snow is hard and sledging good. You see?" He stopped again to cough. A hectic flush filled his hollow cheeks, and there was a feverish glow in his eyes. As he bent his head, the priest looked at Wayman. The doctor's lips were tense. His cigarette was unlit. "I know what it means for a woman to die a-workin'," Severn went on. "My mother did that. I can remember it, though I was only a kid. She was bent and stoop-shouldered, and her hands were rough and twisted. I know why she used to hug me close and croon funny things over me when Father was away. When I first told Marie what I was going to do, she laughed at me. but when I told her about my mother, and how work and freezin' and starvin' killed her when I needed her most, Marie just put up her hand to her face and looked queer, and then she burst out crying like a baby. She understands, Marie does. She knows what I'm going to do. You mustn't talk any more, Bucky, warned the doctor, feeling his pulse. It'll hurt you. Hurt me? Severn laughed hysterically, as if what the doctor had said was a joke. Hurt me? It's going to put me on my feet, Doc. I know it now. I've been too much alone this last winter, with nothing but my dogs to talk to when night come. I ain't never been much of a talker, but she got me out of that. She used to tease me at first, and I'd get red in the face and almost bust. And then one day, it come, like a bung out of a hole, and I've been hankering to talk ever since. Hurt me? He gave an incredulous chuckle, which ended in a cough. Do you know, I wish I could read better than I can, he said suddenly, leaning almost eagerly toward Father Brochet. She knows I ain't great shucks at that. She's going to have a school just as soon as she comes, and I'm going to be the scholar. She's got a pack full of books and magazines, and I'm going to tote over a fresh load every winter. I'd like to surprise her. Can't you help me to— Wayman pressed him back gently. See here, Bucky, you've got to lay down and keep quiet, he said. If you don't, it will take you a week longer to get well. Try and sleep a little, while Father Brochet and I go outside and see what you've done. When they went out, Wayman closed the door after them. He spoke no word as he turned and looked upon what Bucky Severn had done for the coming of his bride. Father Brochet's hands touched the doctor's, and it was cold and trembling. How is he? He asked. It's a bad malady, said Wayman softly. The frost has touched his lungs. One does not feel the effect until spring comes. Then a cough, and the lungs begin literally to slough away. You mean that there's no hope? Absolutely none. He will die within 2 days. As he spoke, the little priest straightened himself and lifted his hands as if to pronounce a benediction. Thank God, he breathed. Then, as quickly, he caught himself. No, I don't mean that. God forgive me. But it is best. Wayman stared incredulously into his face. It is best, repeated the other, as gently as if speaking a prayer. How strangely the Creator sometimes works out his ends. I came straight here from Split Lake. Marie LeCorne died 2 weeks ago. It was I who said the last prayer over her dead body. End of Bucky Severn by James Kerwood. Read by Rowdy Delaney, Idaho, USA.
From a Back Window by Bret Hart. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. From a Back Window by Bret Hart. I remember that long ago, as a sanguine and trustful child, I became possessed of a highly colored lithograph representing a fair Circassian sitting by a window. The price I paid for this work of art may have been extravagant, even in youth's fluctuating slate-pencil currency. But the secret joy I felt in its possession knew no pecuniary equivalent. It was not alone that nature in Circassia lavished alike upon the cheek of beauty and the vegetable kingdom that most expensive of colors, lake. Nor was it that the rose which bloomed beside the fair Circassia's window had no visible stem, and was directly grafted upon a marble balcony, but it was because it embodied an idea. That idea was a hinting of my fate. I felt that somewhere a young and fair Circassian was sitting by a window looking out for me. The idea of resisting such an array of charms and color never occurred to me, and to my honor be it recorded that during the feverish period of adolescence I never thought of averting my destiny. But as vacation and holiday came and went, and as my picture at first grew blurred, and then faded quite away between the eastern and western continents in my atlas, so its charm seemed mysteriously to pass away. When I became convinced that few females of Circassian or other origin sat pensively, resting their chins on their henna-tinged nails, at their parlor windows, I turned my attention to back windows. Although the fair Circassian has not yet burst upon me with open shutters, some peculiarities not unworthy of note have fallen under my observation. This knowledge has not been gained without sacrifice. I have made myself familiar with back windows and their prospects, in the weak disguise of seeking lodgings, heedless of the suspicious glances of landladies and their evident reluctance to show them. I have caught cold by long exposure to draughts. I have become estranged from friends by unconsciously walking to their back windows during a visit, when the weekly linen hung upon the line, or where Miss Fanny, ostensibly indisposed, actually assisted in the laundry, and Master Bobby, in scant attire, disported himself on the area railings. But I have thought of Galileo, and the invariable experience of all seekers and discoverers of truth has sustained me. Show me the back windows of a man's dwelling, and I will tell you his character. The rear of a house only is sincere. The attitude of deception kept up at the front windows leaves the back area defenseless. The world enters at the front door, but nature comes out at the back passage. That glossy, well-brushed individual who lets himself in with the latchkey at the front door at night is a very different being from the slipshod wretch who growls of mornings for hot water at the door of the kitchen. The same with Madam, whose contour of figure grows angular, whose face grows pallid, whose hair comes down, and who looks some 10 years older through the sincere medium of a back window. No wonder that intimate friends fail to recognize each other in this dos-a-dos position. You may imagine yourself familiar with the silver doorplate and bow windows of the mansion where dwells your Saccharissa. You may even fancy you recognize her graceful figure between the lace curtains of the upper chamber, which you fondly imagine to be hers. But you shall dwell for months in the rear of her dwelling and within whispering distance of her bower, and never know it. You shall see her with a handkerchief tied round her head in confidential discussion with the butcher, and know her not. You shall hear her voice in shrill expostulation with her younger brother, and it shall awaken no familiar response. I am writing at the back window, as I prefer the warmth of my coal fire to the foggy freshness of the afternoon breeze that rattles the leafless shrubs in the garden below me. I have my window sash closed. Consequently, I miss much of the shrill altercation that has been going on in the kitchen of number 7 just opposite. I have heard fragments of an entertaining style of dialogue, usually known as chaffing, which has just taken place between Biddy and number 9 and the butcher who brings the dinner. I have been pitying the chilled aspect of a poor canary put out to taste the fresh air from the window of number 5. I have been watching, and envying, I fear, the real enjoyment of 2 children raking over an old dust heap in the alley, containing the wastes and debris of all the backyards in the neighborhood. What a wealth of soda water bottles and old iron they have acquired. But I am waiting for an even more familiar prospect from my back window. I know that later in the afternoon, when the evening paper comes, a thick-set, gray-haired man will appear in his shirt-sleeves at the back door of number 9, and seating himself on the doorstep, begin to read. He lives in a pretentious house, and I hear he is a rich man. But there is such humility in his attitude, and such evidence of gratitude at being allowed to sit outside of his own house and read his paper in his shirt-sleeves, that I can picture his domestic history pretty clearly. Perhaps he is following some old habit of humbler days. Perhaps he has entered into an agreement with his wife not to indulge his disgraceful habit indoors. He does not look like a man who could be coaxed into a dressing gown. In front of his own palatial residence, I know him to be a quiet and respectable middle-aged businessman. But it is from my back window that my heart warms towards him in his shirt-sleeved simplicity. So I sit and watch him in the twilight as he reads gravely, and wonder sometimes, when he looks up, squares his chest, and folds his paper thoughtfully over his knee, whether he doesn't fancy he hears the letting down of bars, or the tinkling of bells, as the cows come home, and stand lowing for him at the gate. End of From a Back Window by Bret Harte. Read for LibriVox.org by Alan Davis Drake.
By Maxim Gorky. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. This reading by Paul Curran in the Hills of Northern England. Her Lover by Maxim Gorky. An acquaintance of mine once told me the following story. When I was a student at Moscow, I happened to live alongside one of those ladies whose repute is questionable. She was a Pole, and they called her Teresa. She was a tallish, powerfully built brunette, with black, bushy eyebrows and a large, coarse face, as if carved out by a hatchet. The bestial gleam of her dark eyes, her thick bass voice, her cabman-like gait, and her immense muscular vigour, worthy of a fishwife, inspired me with horror. I lived on the top flight, and her garret was opposite to mine. I never left my door open when I knew her to be at home, but this, after all, was a very rare occurrence. Sometimes I chanced to meet her on the staircase or in the yard, and she would smile upon me with a smile which seemed to me to be sly and cynical. Occasionally I saw her drunk, with bleary eyes, tousled hair, and a particularly hideous grin. On such occasions she would speak to me. "How do you do, Mr. Student?" And her stupid laugh would still further intensify my loathing of her. I should have liked to have changed my quarters in order to have avoided such encounters and greetings. But my little chamber was a nice one, and there was such a wide view from the window, and it was always so quiet in the street below. So I endured. And one morning I was sprawling on my couch, trying to find some sort of excuse for not attending my class, when the door opened, and the bass voice of Teresa the Loathsome resounded from my threshold. "Good health to you, Mr. Student." "What do you want?" I said. I saw that her face was confused and supplicatory. It was a very unusual sort of face for her. "Sir, I want to beg a favour of you. Will you grant it me?" I lay there, silent, and thought to myself, "Gracious, courage, my boy." "I want to send a letter home, that's what it is," she said. Her voice was beseeching, soft, timid. "Deuce take you," I thought. But up I jumped, sat down at my table, took a sheet of paper and said, "Come here, sit down, and dictate." She came, sat down very gingerly on a chair, and looked at me with a guilty look. "Well, to whom do you want me to write?" "To Boleslav Kashput, at the town of Svietziana, on the Warsaw Road." "Well, fire away." "My dear Boles, my darling, my faithful lover, may the Mother of God protect thee. Thou heart of gold, why hast thou not written for such a long time to thy sorrowing little dove, Teresa?" I very nearly burst out laughing. A sorrowing little dove, more than 5 feet high, with fists of stone and more in weight, and as black as a face, as if the little dove had lived all its life in a chimney, and had never once washed itself. Restraining myself somehow, I asked, "Who is this Bolest?" "Boles, Mr. Student," she said, as if offended with me for blundering over the name. "He is Boles, my young man." "Young man? Why are you so surprised, sir? Cannot I, a girl, have a young man?" "She, a girl? Well!" "Oh, why not?" I said. "All things are possible. And has he been your young man long?" "6 years." "Oh," I thought. "Well, let us write your letter. And I tell you plainly that I would willingly have changed places with this Boles if his fair correspondent had not been Teresa, but something less than she. I thank you most heartily, sir, for your kind service," said Teresa to me with a curtsy. "Perhaps I can show you some service, eh?" "No, I most humbly thank you all the same. Perhaps, sir, your shirts or your trousers may want a little mending." I felt that this mastodon in petticoats had made me grow quite red with shame, and I told her pretty sharply that I had no need whatever of her services. She departed. A week or two passed away. It was evening. I was sitting at my window whistling and thinking of some expedient for enabling me to get away from myself. I was bored, the weather was dirty, and I didn't want to go out, and out of sheer ennui I began a course of self-analysis and reflection. This also was dull enough work, but I didn't care about doing anything else. Then the door opened. Heaven be praised. Someone came in. "Oh, Mr. Student, you have no pressing business, I hope?" It was Teresa. No, what is it? I was going to ask you, sir, to write me another letter. Very well, to Boles, eh? No, this time it is from him. What? Stupid that I am, it is not for me, Mr. Student, I beg your pardon. It is for a friend of mine, that is to say, not a friend, but an acquaintance, a man acquaintance. He has a sweetheart just like me here, Teresa, that's how it is. Will you, sir, write a letter to this Teresa? I looked at her. Her face was troubled, her fingers were trembling. I was a bit fogged at first, and then I guessed how it was. "Look here, my lady," I said. "There are no Boleses or Teresas at all, and you've been telling me a pack of lies. Don't you come sneaking about me any longer. I have no wish whatever to cultivate your acquaintance. Do you understand?" And suddenly she grew strangely terrified and distraught. She began to shift from foot to foot without moving from the place, and spluttered comically, as if she wanted to say something and couldn't. I waited to see what would come of all this, and I saw and felt that, apparently, I had made a great mistake in suspecting her of wishing to draw me from the path of righteousness. It was evidently something very different. "Mr. Student," she began, and suddenly, waving her hand, she turned abruptly towards the door and went out. I remained with a very unpleasant feeling in my mind. I listened. Her door was flung violently to. Plainly the poor wench was very angry. I thought it over, and resolved to go to her, and, inviting her to come in here, write everything she wanted. I entered her apartment. I looked around. She was sitting at the table, leaning on her elbows, with her head in her hands. "Listen to me," I said. "Now, whenever I come to this point in my story, I always feel horribly awkward and idiotic. Well, "Listen to me," I said. She leapt from her seat, came towards me with flashing eyes, and laying her hands on my shoulders began to whisper, or rather hum, in her peculiar bass voice. "Look you now, it's like this. There's no Boles at all, and there's no Teresa either. But what's that to you? Is it a hard thing for you to draw your pen over paper, eh? Ah, and you? Still such a little fair-haired boy. There's nobody at all, neither Boles nor Teresa. Only me. There you have it. And much good may it do you." "Pardon me," said I, altogether flabbergasted by such a reception. "What is it all about? There's no Boles, you say?" "No, so it is." "And no Teresa either?" "And no Teresa. I'm Teresa." I didn't understand it at all. I fixed my eyes upon her and tried to make out which of us was taking leave of his or her senses, but she went again to the table, searched about for something, came back to me, and said, in an offended tone, "If it was so hard for you to write to Boles, look, here's your letter, take it. Others will write for me." I looked. In her hand was my letter to Boles. "Listen, Teresa, what's the meaning of all this? Why must you get others to write for you when I have already written it, and you haven't sent it?" "Sent it where?" "Why, to this Boles." "There's no such person." I absolutely did not understand it. There was nothing for me but to spit and go. Then she explained. "What is it?" she said, still offended. "There's no such person, I tell you." And she extended her arms as if she herself did not understand why there should be no such person. "But I wanted him to be. Am I, then, not a human creature like the rest of them? Yes, yes, I know, of course. Yet no harm was done to anyone by my writing to him that I can see." "Pardon me? To whom?" "To Boles, of course. But he doesn't exist." "Alas, alas! Well, what if he doesn't? He doesn't exist, but he might. I write to him, and it looks as if he did exist, and Teresa, that's me, and he replies to me, and then I write to him again." I understood at last, and I felt so sick, so miserable, so ashamed somehow. Alongside of me, not 3 yards away, lived a human creature who had nobody in the world to treat her kindly, affectionately, and this human being had invented a friend for herself. "Look now, you wrote me a letter to Boles, and I gave it to someone else to read it to me, and when they read it to me, I listened and fancied that Boles was there. And I asked you to write me a letter from Boles to Teresa, that is, to me. When they write such a letter for me, and read it to me, I feel quite sure that Boles is there, and life grows easier for me in consequence." "Deuce take you for a blockhead," I said to myself when I heard this. And from thenceforth, regularly, twice a week, I wrote a letter to Boles, and an answer from Boles to Teresa. I wrote those answers well. She, of course, listened to them and wept like anything, roared, I should say, with her bass voice. And in return for my thus moving her to tears by real letters from the imaginary Boles, she began to mend the holes I had in my socks, shirts, and other articles of clothing. Subsequently, about 3 months after this history began, they put her in prison for something or other. No doubt by this time she's dead. My acquaintance shook the ash from his cigarette, looked pensively up at the sky, and thus concluded, "Well, well, the more a human creature has tasted of bitter things, the more it hungers after the sweet things of life, and we, wrapped round in the rags of our virtues, and regarding others through the mist of our self-sufficiency, and persuaded of our universal impeccability, do not understand this. And the whole thing turns out pretty stupidly, and very cruelly. The fallen classes, we say. And who are the fallen classes? I should like to know. They are, first of all, people with the same bones, flesh, and blood, and nerves as ourselves. We have been told this day after day for ages, and we actually listen. And the devil only knows how hideous the whole thing is. Or, are we completely depraved by the loud sermonizing of humanism? In reality, we also are fallen folks, and so far as I can see, very deeply fallen into the abyss of self-sufficiency and the conviction of our own superiority. But enough of this. It is all as old as the hills, so old that it is a shame to speak of it. Very old indeed. Yes, that's what it is. The End of Her Lover by Maxim Gorky.
Queen Bee by the Brothers Grimm. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Queen Bee. Two king's sons once upon a time went into the world to seek their fortunes, but they soon fell into a wasteful, foolish way of living so that they could not return home again. Then their brother, who was a little insignificant dwarf, went out to seek for his brothers. But when he had found them, they only laughed at him, to think that he, who was so young and simple, should try to travel the world when they, who were so much wiser, had been unable to get on. However, they all set out on their journey together, and it came at last to an anthill. The two elder brothers would have pulled it down in order to see how the poor ants in their fright would run about and carry off their eggs, but the little dwarf said, "Let the poor things enjoy themselves. I will not suffer you to trouble them." So on they went, and came to a lake where many, many ducks were swimming about. The two brothers wanted to catch two and roast them, but the dwarf said, "Let the poor things enjoy themselves, you shall not kill them." Next they came to a bee's nest in a hollow tree, and there was so much honey that it ran down the trunk, and the two brothers wanted to light a fire under the tree and kill the bees, so as to get their honey. But the dwarf held them back and said, "Let the pretty insects enjoy themselves, I cannot let you burn them." At length the three brothers came to a castle, and as they passed by the stables they saw fine horses standing there, but all were of marble, and no man was to be seen. Then they went through all the rooms till they came to a door on which there were three locks, but in the middle of the door was a wicket, so that they could look into the next room. There they saw a little gray old man sitting at a table, and they called to him once or twice, but he did not hear. However, they called a third time, and then he rose and came out to them. He said nothing, but took hold of them and led them to a beautiful table covered with all sorts of good things, and when they had eaten and drunk, he showed each of them to a bedchamber. The next morning he came to the eldest and took him to a marble table where there were three tablets containing an account of the means by which the castle might be disenchanted. The first tablet said, "In the wood under the moss lie the 1,000 pearls belonging to the king's daughter. They must all be found. And if one be missing by set of the sun, he who seeks them will be turned into marble." The eldest brother set out and sought for the pearls the whole day, but the evening came and he had not found the 100, so he was turned into stone as the tablet had foretold. The next day the second brother undertook the task, but he succeeded no better than the first, for he could only find the 200 of the pearls, and therefore he too was turned into stone. At last came the little dwarf's turn. He looked into the moss, but it was so hard to find the pearls, and the job was so tiresome. So he sat upon a stone and cried. And as he sat there, the king of the ants, whose life he had saved, came up to help him, with 5,000 ants, and it was not long before they had found all the pearls and laid them in a heap. The second tablet said, "The key of the princess's bedchamber must be fished up out of the lake." And as the dwarf came to the brink of it, he saw the two ducks whose lives he had saved swimming about, and they dived down and soon brought in the key from the bottom. The third task was the hardest. It was to choose out the youngest and best of all the king's three daughters. Now they were all beautiful and all exactly alike, but he was told that the eldest had eaten a piece of sugar, the next some sweet syrup, and the youngest a spoonful of honey. So he was to guess which it was that had eaten the honey. Then came the queen of the bees, who had been saved by the little dwarf from the fire, and she tried the lips of all three, but at last she sat upon the lips of the one who had eaten the honey, and so the dwarf knew which one was the youngest. Thus the spell was broken, and all who had been turned into stones awoke and took their proper forms. And the dwarf married the youngest and the best of all the princesses, and was the king after his father's death, but his two brothers married the two other sisters. End of The Queen Bee.
The Story of Kish by Jack London. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information and to learn how to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. The Story of Kish by Jack London. Kish lived long ago on the rim of the polar sea, was headman of his village through many and prosperous years, and died full of honors with his name on the lips of men. So long ago did he live that only the old men remember his name and the tale which they got from the old men before them, and which the old men to come will tell to their children and their children's children down to the end of time. And the winter darkness, when the north gales make their long sweeps across the ice pack, and the air is filled with flying white, and no man may venture forth, is the chosen time for the telling of how Kish, from the poorest igloo in the village, rose to power and place over them all. He was a bright boy, so the tale runs, healthy and strong, and he had seen 13 suns, in their way of reckoning time. For each winter the sun leaves the land in darkness, and the next year a new sun returns, so that they may be warm again and look upon one another's faces. The father of Kish had been a very brave man, but he had met his death in a time of famine, when he had sought to save the lives of his people by taking the life of a great polar bear. In his eagerness he came to close grapples with the bear, and his bones were crushed. But the bear had much meat on him, and the people were saved. Kish was his only son, and after that Kish lived alone with his mother. But the people are prone to forget, and they forgot the deed of his father, and he being but a boy, and his mother only a woman, they too were swiftly forgotten, and ere long came to live in the meanest of all the igloos. It was at a council one night, in the big igloo of Klosh Kwan, the chief, that Kish showed the blood that ran in his veins, and the manhood that stiffened his back. With the dignity of an elder, he rose to his feet, and waited for silence amid the babble of voices. "It is true that meat be apportioned me and mine," he said, "but it is oft-times old and tough, this meat, and moreover it has an unusual quantity of bones." The hunters, grizzled and gray, and lusty and young, were aghast. The like had never been known before. A child that talked like a grown man, and said harsh things to their very faces. But steadily and with seriousness Kish went on. "For that I know my father Bach was a great hunter, I speak these words. It is said that Bach brought home more meat than any of the two best hunters, that with his own hands he attended to the division of it, that with his own eyes he saw to it that the least old woman and the last old man received fair share."
"Na, na,"
the men cried, "put the child out, send him off to bed. He is no man that he should talk to men and greybeards." He waited calmly till the uproar died down. "Thou hast a wife, Ugluk," he said, "and for her dost thou speak. And thou too, Masuk, a mother also, and for them dost thou speak. My mother has no one save me, wherefore I speak. As I said, though Bach be dead, because he hunted over keenly, it is just that I, who am his son, and that Aikiga, who is my mother and was his wife, should have meat in plenty, so long as there be meat in plenty in the tribe. I, Kish, the son of Bach, have spoken." He sat down, his ears keenly alert to the flood of protest and indignation his words had created.
"That a boy should speak in council," old Ugluk was mumbling.
Shall the babes in arms tell us men the things we do? Masuk demanded in a loud voice. Am I a man that I should be made a mock by every child that cries for meat? The anger boiled a white heat. They ordered him to bed, threatened that he should have no meat at all, and promised him sore beatings for his presumption. Keesh's eyes began to flash, and the blood to pound darkly under his skin. In the midst of the abuse, he sprang to his feet. "Hear me, ye men," he cried. "Never shall I speak in the council again, never again, till the men come to me and say, 'It is well, Keesh, that thou shouldst speak. It is well, and it is our wish.' Take now this, ye men, for my last word. Bak, my father, was a great hunter. I, too, his son, shall go and hunt the meat that I eat. And be it known now that the division of that which I kill shall be fair. And no widow nor weak one shall cry in the night because there is no meat, when the strong men are groaning in great pain for that they have eaten overmuch. And in the days to come there shall be shame upon the strong men who have eaten overmuch. I, Keesh, have said it." Jeers and scornful laughter followed him out of the igloo, but his jaw was set, and he went his way, looking neither to right nor left. The next day he went forth along the shoreline where the ice and the land meet together. Those who saw him go noted that he carried his bow, with a goodly supply of bone-barbed arrows, and that across his shoulders was his father's big hunting spear. And there was laughter and much talk at the event. It was an unprecedented occurrence. Never did boys of his tender age go forth to hunt, much less to hunt alone. Also were there shaking of heads and prophetic mutterings, and the women looked pityingly at Ikeega, and her face was grave and sad. "He will be back ere long," they said cheeringly. "Let him go. It will teach him a lesson," the hunters said. "And he will come back shortly, and he will be meek and soft of speech in the days to follow." But a day passed, and a second, and on the third a wild gale blew, and there was no Keesh. Ikeega tore her hair, and put soot of the seal oil on her face in token of her grief. And the women assailed the men with bitter words in that they had mistreated the boy and sent him to his death. And the men made no answer, preparing to go in search of the body when the storm abated. Early next morning, however, Keesh strode into the village, but he came not shamefacedly. Across his shoulders he bore a burden of fresh-killed meat, and there was importance in his step and arrogance in his speech. "Go, ye men, with the dogs and sledges, and take my trail for the better part of the day's travel," he said. "There is much meat on the ice, a she-bear and two half-grown cubs." Ikeega was overcome with joy, but he received her demonstrations in manlike fashion, saying, "Come, Ikeega, let us eat, and after that I shall sleep, for I am weary." And he passed into their igloo and ate profoundly, and after that slept for 20 running hours. There was much doubt at first, much doubt and discussion. The killing of a polar bear is very dangerous, but thrice dangerous it is, and three times thrice, to kill a mother bear with her cubs. The men could not bring themselves to believe that the boy Keesh, single-handedly, had accomplished so great a marvel. But the women spoke of the fresh-killed meat he had brought on his back, and this was an overwhelming argument against their unbelief. So they finally departed, grumbling greatly that in all probability, if the things were so, he had neglected to cut up the carcass. Now in the north it is very necessary that this should be done as soon as a kill is made. If not, the meat freezes so solidly as to turn the edges of the sharpest knife. And a 300-pound bear, frozen stiff, is no easy thing to put on a sled and haul over the rough ice. But, arrived at the spot, they found not only the kill, which they had doubted, but that Kish had quartered the beast in true hunter fashion and removed the entrails. Thus began the mystery of Kish, a mystery that deepened and deepened with the passing of the days. His very next trip he killed a young bear, nearly full grown, and on the trip following, a large male bear and his mate. He was ordinarily gone from 3 to 4 days, though it was nothing unusual for him to stay away a week at a time in the ice field. Always he declined company on these expeditions, and the people marveled. "How does he do it?" they demanded of one another. "Never does he take a dog with him, and dogs are of such great help, too." "Why dost thou hunt only bear?" Klosh Kwan once ventured to ask him. And Kish made fitting answer. "It is well known that there is more meat on the bear," he said. But there was also talk of witchcraft in the village. "He hunts with evil spirits," some of the people contended. "Wherefore his hunting is rewarded. How else can it be, save that he hunts with evil spirits?" "Mayhap they are not evil, but good, these spirits," others said. "It is known that his father was a mighty hunter. May not his father hunt with him, so that he may attain excellence and patience and understanding? Who knows?" Nonetheless, his success continued, and the less successful hunters were often kept busy hauling in his meat. And in the division of it, he was just. As his father had done before him, he saw to it that the least old woman and the last old man received a fair portion, keeping no more for himself than his needs required. And because of this, and of his merit as a hunter, he was looked upon with respect and even awe, and there was talk of making him chief after old Klosh Kwan. Because of the things he had done, they looked for him to appear again in the council, but he never came, and they were ashamed to ask. "I am minded to build me an igloo," he said one day to Klosh Kwan and a number of the hunters. "It shall be a large igloo, wherein Ikiga and I can dwell in comfort." "Aye," they nodded gravely. "But I have no time. My business is hunting, and it takes all my time. So it is but just that the men and women of the village who eat my meat should build me my igloo." And the igloo was built accordingly, on a generous scale which exceeded even the dwelling of Klosh Kwan. Kish and his mother moved into it, and it was the first prosperity she had enjoyed since the death of Bach. Nor was material prosperity alone hers, for, because of her wonderful son and the position he had given her, she came to be looked upon as the first woman in the village, and the women were given to visiting her, to asking her advice, and to quoting her wisdom when arguments arose among themselves or with the men. But it was the mystery of Kish's marvelous hunting that took chief place in all their minds. And one day a Glug taxed him with witchcraft to his face. "It is charged," a Gluck said ominously, "that thou dealest with evil spirits, wherefore thy hunting is rewarded." "Is not the meat good?" Kish made answer. "Has one in the village yet to fall sick from the eating of it? How dost thou know that witchcraft be concerned? or dost thou guess, in the dark, merely because of the envy that consumes thee?" And Ugluk withdrew discomfited. The women laughed at him as he walked away. But in the council one night, after long deliberation, it was determined to put spies on his track when he went forth to hunt, so that his methods might be learned. So, on his next trip, Bim and Bawn, two young men, and of hunters the craftiest, followed after him, taking care not to be seen. After 5 days they returned, their eyes bulging and their tongues a-tremble, to tell what they had seen. The council was hastily called in Klosh Kwan's dwelling, and Bim took up the tale.
"Brothers, as commanded, we journeyed on the trail of Kish, and cunningly we journeyed, so that he might not know. And midway of the first day, he picked up with a great he-bear. It was a very great bear."
"None greater," Bawn corroborated, and went on himself.
"Yet was the bear not inclined to fight, for he turned away and made off slowly over the ice. This we saw from the rocks of the shore, and the bear came towards us, and after him came Kish, very much unafraid. And he shouted harsh words after the bear, and he waved his arms about, and made much noise. Then did the bear grow angry, and rise up on his hind legs and growl. But Kish walked right up to the bear."
"Aye," Bim continued the story,
"right up to the bear Kish walked, and the bear looked after him, and Kish ran away. But as he ran, he dropped a little round ball on the ice, and the bear stopped and smelled it, then swallowed it up. And Kish continued to run away and drop little round balls, and the bear continued to swallow them." Exclamations and cries of doubt were being made, and Ugluk expressed open unbelief.
"With our own eyes we saw it," Bim affirmed.
And Bawn, "Aye, with our own eyes. And this continued until the bear stood suddenly upright and cried aloud in pain and thrashed his forepaws madly about. And Kish continued to make off over the ice to a safe distance. But the bear gave him no notice, being occupied with the misfortune the little round balls had wrought within him."
"Aye, within him," Bim interrupted, "for he did claw at himself and leap about over the ice like a playful puppy. Save from the way he growled and squealed, it was plain it was not play, but pain. Never did I see such a sight."
"Nay, never was such a sight seen," Bawn took up the strain,
"and furthermore, it was such a large bear."
"Witchcraft," Ugluk suggested.
"I know not," Bawn replied. "I tell you of what my eyes beheld. And after a while the bear grew weak and tired, for he was very heavy, and he had jumped about with exceeding violence, and he went off along the shore ice, shaking his head slowly from side to side, and sitting down ever and again to squeal and cry. And Kish followed after the bear, and we followed after Kish, and for that day and 3 days more we followed. The bear grew weak, and never ceased crying from his pain."
"It was a charm," Ugluk exclaimed. "Surely it was a charm."
"It may well be."
And Bim relieved Bawn. The bear wandered, now this way and now that, doubling back and forth and crossing his trail in circles, so that at the end he was near where Kish had first come upon him. By this time he was quite sick, the bear, and could crawl no farther. So Kish came up close and speared him to death.
"And then?" Klosh Kwan demanded.
"Then we left Kish, skinning the bear, and came running that the news of the killing might be told."
And in the afternoon of that day the women hauled in the meat of the bear, while the men sat in council assembled. When Kish arrived, a messenger was sent to him, bidding him come to the council. But he sent reply, saying that he was hungry and tired, and that his igloo was large and comfortable, and could hold many men. And curiosity was so strong on the men that the whole council, Klosh Kwan to the fore, rose up and went to the igloo of Kish. He was eating, but he received them with respect and seated them according to their rank. Aikiga was proud and embarrassed by turns, but Kish was quite composed. Klosh Kwan recited the information brought by Bim and Bon, and at its close said in a stern voice, "So, explanation is wanted, O Kish, of thy manner of hunting. Is there witchcraft in it?"
Kish looked up and smiled. "Nay, O Klosh Kwan, it is not for a boy to know aught of witches, and of witches I know nothing. I have but devised the means whereby I may kill the ice bear with ease, that is all.
It be headcraft, not witchcraft."
"And may any man?"
"Any man." There was a long silence. The men looked in one another's faces, and Kish went on eating.
And
wilt thou tell us, O Kish?" Klosh Kwan finally asked in a tremulous voice.
"Yea, I will tell thee."
Kish finished sucking a marrow bone and rose to his feet.
"It is quite simple. Behold."
He picked up a thin strip of whalebone and showed it to them. The ends were sharp as needle points. The strip he coiled carefully till it disappeared in his hand. Then suddenly releasing it, it sprang straight again. He picked up a piece of blubber.
"So," he said, "one takes a small chunk of blubber, thus, and thus makes it hollow. Then into the hollow goes the whalebone, so tightly coiled, and another piece of blubber is fitted over the whalebone. After that, it is put outside, where it freezes into a little round ball. The bear swallows the little round ball, the blubber melts, the whalebone with its sharp ends stands out straight. The bear gets sick, and when the bear is very sick, why, you kill him with a spear. It's quite simple."
And Ugluk said, "Oh!" And Klosh Kwan said, "Ah!" And each said something after his own manner, and all understood. And this is the story of Kish, who lived long ago on the rim of the polar sea. Because he exercised headcraft and not witchcraft, he rose from the meanest igloo to be head man of his village. And through all the years that he lived, it is related, his tribe was prosperous. And neither widow nor weak one cried aloud in the night because there was no meat. End of The Story of Kish by Jack London. This recording is in the public domain. Read by Alan Davis Drake. The Student by Anton Chekhov. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Student by Anton Chekhov. At first the weather was fine and still. The thrushes were calling, and in the swamps close by, something alive droned pitifully with a sound like blowing into an empty bottle. A snipe flew by,
and the shot aimed at it rang out with a gay resounding note in the spring air. But when it began to get dark in the forest, a cold penetrating wind blew inappropriately from the east, and everything sank into silence. Needles of ice stretched across the pools, and it felt cheerless, remote, and lonely in the forest. There was a whiff of winter. Ivan Velikopolsky, the son of a sacristan and a student of the clerical academy, returned home from shooting, kept walking on the path by the waterlogged meadow. His fingers were numb, and his face was burning with the wind. It seemed to him that the cold that had suddenly come on had destroyed the order and harmony of things, that nature itself felt ill at ease, and that was why the evening darkness was falling more rapidly than usual. All around it was deserted and peculiarly gloomy. The only light was one gleaming in the widow's garden near the river. The village, over 3 miles away, and everything in the distance all around, was plunged in the cold evening mist. The student remembered that, as he had left the house, his mother was sitting barefoot on the floor in the entryway, cleaning the samovar, while his father lay on the stove, coughing. As it was Good Friday, nothing had been cooked, and the student was terribly hungry. And now, shrinking from the cold, he thought that just such a wind had blown in the days of Rurik, and in the time of Ivan the Terrible and Peter. And in their time there had been just the same desperate poverty and hunger, the same thatched roofs with holes in them, ignorance, misery, the same desolation around, the same darkness, the same feeling of oppression. All these existed, did exist, and would exist, and the lapse of 1,000 years would make life no better. And he did not want to go home. The gardens were called the widows because they were kept by two widows, mother and daughter. A campfire was burning brightly with a crackling sound, throwing out light far around on the ploughed earth. The widow, Vasilisa, a tall, fat old woman in a man's coat, was standing by and looking thoughtfully into the fire. Her daughter, Lukiria, a little pockmarked woman with a stupid-looking face, was sitting on the ground, washing a cauldron and spoons. Apparently they had just had supper. There was a sound of men's voices. It was the laborers watering their horses at the river. "Here you have winter back again," said the student, going up to the campfire. "Good evening." Vasilisa started, but at once recognized him and smiled cordially. "I did not know you. God bless you," she said. "You'll be rich." They talked. Vasilisa, a woman of experience who had been in service with the gentry, first as a wet nurse, afterwards as a child's nurse, expressed herself with refinement, and a soft, sedate smile never left her face. Her daughter, Lukiria, a village peasant woman who had been beaten by her husband, simply screwed up her eyes at the student and said nothing, and she had a strange expression like that of a deaf mute. "At just such a fire the Apostle Peter warmed himself," said the student, stretching out his hands to the fire. "So it must have been cold then, too. Ah, what a terrible night it must have been, Granny! An utterly dismal long night." He looked round at the darkness, shook his head abruptly, and asked, "No doubt you have heard the reading of the 12 apostles.
"Yes, I have," answered Vasilisa. "If you remember, at the Last Supper, Peter said to Jesus, 'I am ready to go with thee into darkness and into death.' And our Lord answered him thus, 'I say unto thee, Peter, before the cock crowest, thou wilt have denied me thrice.' After the supper, Jesus went through the agony of death in the garden,
and prayed, and poor Peter was weary in spirit and faint. His eyelids were heavy, and he could not struggle against sleep. He fell asleep. Then you heard how Judas, the same night, kissed Jesus and betrayed him to his tormentors. They took him bound to the high priest and beat him, while Peter, exhausted, worn out with misery and alarm, hardly awoke, you know, feeling that something awful was just about to happen on earth, followed behind. He loved Jesus passionately, intensely, and now he saw from far off how he was beaten. Lucuria left the spoons and fixed an immovable stare upon the student. They came to the high priests, he went on. They began to question Jesus, and meantime the laborers made a fire in the yard as it was cold, and warmed themselves. Peter, too, stood with them near the fire and warmed himself, as I am doing. A woman, seeing him, said, "He was with Jesus, too." That is as much as to say that he, too, should be taken to be questioned. And all the laborers that were standing near the fire must have looked sourly and suspiciously at him, because he was confused and said, "I don't know him." A little while after, again one had recognized him as one of Jesus' disciples and said, "Thou too art one of them." But again he denied it. And for the third time someone turned to him, "Why, did I not see thee with him in the garden today?" For the third time he denied it. And immediately after that time the cock crowed, and Peter, looking from afar off at Jesus, remembered the words he had said to him in the evening. He remembered, he came to himself, went out to the yard, and wept bitterly. Bitterly. In the Gospel it is written, "He went out and wept bitterly." I imagine it, the still, still, dark, dark garden, and, in the stillness, faintly audible, smothered sobbing. The student sighed and sank into thought. Still smiling, Vasilisa suddenly gave a gulp. Big tears flowed freely down her cheeks, and she screened her face from the fire with her sleeve, as though ashamed of her tears. And Lucuria, staring immovably at the student, flushed crimson, and her expression became strained and heavy, like that of someone enduring intense pain. The laborers came back from the river, and one of them riding a horse was quite near, and the light from the fire quivered upon him. The student said good night to the widows and went on, and again the darkness was about him, and his fingers began to be numb. A cruel wind was blowing. Winter really had come back, and it did not feel as though Easter would be the day after tomorrow. Now the student was thinking about Vasilisa. Since she had shed tears, all that had happened to Peter the night before the crucifixion must have some relation to her. He looked round. The solitary light was still gleaming in the darkness, and no figures could be seen near it now. The student thought again that if Vasilisa had shed tears, and her daughter had been troubled, it was evident that what he had just been telling them about, which had happened 19 centuries ago, had a relation to the present, to both women, to the desolate village, to himself, to all people. The old woman had wept, not because he could tell the story touchingly, but because Peter was near to them, because her whole being was interested in what was passing in Peter's soul. And joy suddenly stirred in his soul, and he even stopped for a minute to take breath. The past, he thought, is linked with the present by an unbroken chain of events flowing one out of another. And it seemed to him
that he had just seen both ends of that chain, that when he touched one end, the other quivered. When he crossed the river by the ferry boat, and afterwards, mounting the hill, looked at his village towards the west, where the cold crimson sunset lay a narrow streak of light, he thought that truth and beauty, which had guided human life there in the garden and in the yard of the high priest, had continued without interruption to this day, and had evidently always been the chief thing in human life, and in all earthly life indeed. And the feeling of youth, health, vigor, he was only 22, and the inexpressible sweet expectation of happiness, of unknown, mysterious happiness, took possession of him little by little, and life seemed to him enchanting, marvelous, and full of lofty meaning. End of The Student by Anton Chekhov. This recording is in the public domain. Read by Alan Davis Drake.
Too Dear for the Whistle by Benjamin Franklin. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. When I was a child of 7 years old, my friends on a holiday filled my pockets with coppers. I went directly to a shop where they sold toys for children, and being charmed with the sound of a whistle that I met by the way in the hands of another boy, I voluntarily offered and gave all my money for one. I then came home and went whistling all over the house, much pleased with my whistle, but disturbing all the family. My brothers and sisters and cousins, understanding the bargain I had made, told me I had given four times as much for it as it was worth, put me in my mind of what good things I might have bought with the rest of the money, and laughed at me so much for my folly that I cried with vexation. And the reflection gave me more chagrin than the whistle gave me pleasure. This, however, was afterwards of use to me, the impression continuing on my mind, so that often when I was tempted to buy some unnecessary thing, I said to myself, "Don't give too much for the whistle," and I saved my money. As I grew up, came into the world, and observed the actions of men, I thought I met with many, very many, who gave too much for the whistle. When I saw one too ambitious of court favor, sacrificing his time and attendance on levees, his repose, his liberty, his virtue, and perhaps his friends, to attain it, I have said to myself, "This man gives too much for his whistle." When I saw another fond of popularity, constantly employing himself in political bustles, neglecting his own affairs and ruining them by that neglect, "He pays indeed," said I, "too dear for his whistle." If I knew a miser who gave up every kind of comfortable living, all the pleasure of doing good to others, all the esteem of his fellow citizens, and the joys of benevolent friendship for the sake of accumulating wealth, "Poor man," said I, "you pay too dear for your whistle." When I met a man of pleasure, sacrificing every laudable improvement of the mind or of his fortune to mere corporeal sensations, and ruining his health in their pursuit, "Mistaken man," said I, "you are providing pain for yourself instead of pleasure. You are paying too dear for your whistle." If I see one fond of appearance or fine clothes, fine houses, fine furniture, fine equipages, all above his fortune, for which he contracts debts, "Alas," say I, "he has paid dear, very dear for his whistle." In short, I conceive that a great part of the miseries of mankind are brought upon them by the false estimate they have made of the value of things, and by their giving too much for their whistles. Benjamin Franklin. Footnote. This extract was taken from a letter which Franklin wrote from Passy in 1779 to Madame Brion. This is the end of Too Dear for the Whistle by Benjamin Franklin, read by Adam from Towson, Maryland, United States.